He wants to make sure that he is the one to mate with any passing females. Spray rocks now take on a whole new significance. This is our local female called Dolma. And if she's coming into breeding condition, she'll want Mi'kmaq to know about it. Dolma's urine carries the vital information. Her normal message of keep away has now become you're welcome to approach. And next day, Mi'kmaq is on her trail. Snow leopards are normally 3 days to a week's walk away from each other. Now he's only 3 hours behind her. And next night he goes to the spray rock to pick up Dolma's message. Her perfume has really impressed him. He's making quite a meal of it. His open mouth and flared nostrils allow him to read her message more clearly. That's a snow leopard calling. We think it's our dark-faced female, Dolma.
From that ridge top since before dawn. This is the only time of year adult snow leopards call to each other. For the rest of the year, all the scrapes and sprays are saying, stay away from me. And now all of a sudden it's, here I am, come and join me. She's chosen a brilliant spot, these cliffs, to bounce the sound off. And these three valleys to the north, the south, and one behind me to funnel the sound further. Clever girl. She's using the very shape of the mountains themselves to overcome their scale. This is definitely Mi'kmaq orbiting around her. If they're like other big cats, they may call like this for hours, just coming together and wandering apart. No one's ever seen a wild mating before, so I just don't know what to expect. Surprised by how gentle this is. These two are really taking their time. Come on, guys. You mating or just sitting together? Now that's definitely mating. Fantastic. We need all the new snow leopards we can get.
It's pretty amazing to film something that hasn't even been seen before. Difficult to believe, really. But can we find the resulting cubs? After this success, Mitchell is feeling more confident.
For the first time since starting, I finally feel like we're starting to get somewhere. And trying to think like the snow leopards and trying to use the terrain like they would. There's still a long way to go, but it feels good high up on these ridge trails, traveling and resting where the snow leopards do. But we're still behind the snow leopards, only anticipating their actions as tiny percentages of the time. The only thing to do, I think, is keep walking and keep looking.
Climbing to high altitude can be dangerous, and Mitchell has already suffered from some alarming headaches. But with the promise of young cubs on the horizon, the team has new energy and determination. We'd failed to find cubs in 3 years of searching, but after witnessing the mating, Mitchell is back for a final summer attempt. Camping high at 15,000 feet, he plans to stake out burral herds in the hope Dolma and her cubs will show up.
Finding the burral herds is easy as usual, but there's no sign of snow leopards. And all day I'm stalked by a biting headache. I become disoriented, and by the next morning, I'm staggering and vomiting. I just can't believe that after all these years, the high altitude is suddenly affecting me. By the next day, I can't even stand and I'm coughing up froth. I hallucinate and twice lose consciousness as Numgul brings me down to base camp on the back of his yak.
Mitchell's final attempt to find small cubs nearly ends in disaster. He's close to death from acute mountain sickness. It is crucial that he be transported to a lower altitude if he is to survive. He's evacuated to the nearest hospital.
Mitchell has shot so much remarkable film that his departure is a big loss. But we're still hoping to find Mi'kmaq and Dolmar's little cubs and film a cat on a kill. So we start our fourth winter in the mountains with clear goals. Mitchell has made a good recovery after leaving hospital, but is unable to return to altitude just yet. So in his absence, we press on. One of our camera sites is on a high ridge, and after a 2-year wait, Mitchell will be delighted to know that a cat has finally visited his favorite spot. Mitchell calls this the menu site, because snow leopards can survey this lovely landscape from up here and decide what they'll kill for their next meal. We're still determined to film those little cubs, or even a snow leopard feeding on a kill. And fresh snowfall is giving us a head start. We find Mi'kmaq out patrolling his territory. He seems casual in his movements, unconcerned as he spooks the herds of burral. Wondering what he's up to, we pick up his tracks and follow him up one of his favorite valleys, hoping he'll lead us to cubs or a kill. And he does. We've obviously disturbed him off this dead burral, and in a panic, quickly snatch a few video shots of the carcass because we've spotted him up on a ridge. Hopefully, he'll return to the kill. So we set up a hide and wait all night. At dawn, we spot Mi'kmaq on guard nearby. He seems too fat to bother chasing scavengers away. So a fox takes its chance to snatch a few morsels, burying them to create a larder for the hard times ahead. Within an hour, Mi'kmaq is back. The life of a